And those fluctuations get bigger and bigger and bigger as the universe ages. Why? Because suppose you've got a little fluctuation in an overdense region, then you've got stuff falling into that overdense region, and that makes it even more overdense. More stuff can fall into it. And it can grow and grow and grow. Each of those fluctuations grows and grows and grows. It's just the nature of gravity that those that initial fluctuations get larger over time. And so, actually, because there's 10 times as much dark matter in the universe, the amount of fluctuations you see in the cosmic microwave background are basically 10 times larger in the dark matter, because there's 10 times as much dark matter. And it's the dark matter fluctuations, overdense amounts of dark matter that produce what today are galaxy clusters and galaxies. And basically you need enough dark matter to be able to produce enough of these galaxies and galaxy clusters to explain what we see today. Yes?
Is there anything called center of the universe? Are there anything, what's the nature of that?
No.
That would be God.
So there's no evidence that there's anything that we would call the center.
It's expanding. Yeah.
I can't think in four dimensions. I don't know, you know anyone who can. But there's a sort of a three-dimensional analog, which is you get a balloon. You take a balloon, and the universe, at the beginning of the universe, that balloon is a certain size, and you blow it up, and it gets bigger. So the space, the area of the balloon, is getting bigger over time. But is it right to say there's a center? Is there a center of the surface of the balloon? There isn't, it's a ball, right? And if you extend that from three dimensions to the balloon to four dimensions, you get something like what cosmologists understand is the way the universe works, that the space itself is getting larger and larger over time, and is actually accelerating apart right now.
So the universe is expanding. Is the mass constant, or is the mass being added to? So is the density static, or going down?
The mass energy density is constant.
You get my drift of, is it a fixed set of mass that's expanding and thus the density is decreasing as the thing is expanding?
The density is certainly decreasing, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. As opposed to creation of mass from something, I don't know what, how to explain it.
Yeah.
Is mass being created, or is mass always constant?
Well, now you're getting a little bit beyond my field of expertise.
That's the whole point of this, is that is there a fixed mass that's doing whatever it's doing? It's expanding, it's contracting, it's always fixed. As opposed to, is the mass being created?
Well, in the Big Bang, there's got a lot of mass being created.
Is it created or just being thrown around?
No, in the way people understand it now, it's actually being created, and the nature of that is not well understood.
Yeah.
So there's a fellow named for another of these. There's a fellow named Richard Easter, who's a theorist at Yale, who does inflation theory, and the nature of inflation is still a big mystery. We don't understand it well at all.
That was really my question coming today. Yeah. Is mass actually being created?
No.
At that point, yes, it is.
Yeah, that makes a huge difference in how to view the universe, as opposed to it's a fixed set of mass simply being manipulated.
Yeah.
Okay, but if you believe that there's actually mass being created, it's like, wow, that is really revolutionary. Wow.
Yeah. That's beyond. That's a different topic from that part.
Forget all that.
There might be a relation that we don't understand between dark energy,
right,
which is causing the universe to expand, and this initial thing.
Yeah, is that a bank? It's a bank of we're drawing out of this thing. We have these repositories of mass in a very concentrated manner. I know this sounds weird. The universe is expanding, it's drawing out of these, it's almost like a reverse black hole. You talked about black holes. You're drawing out to create these galaxies. But what happens when let's say that's true, you know, you've got this concentrated, you know, where I'm wringing it out. Now, what happens when you run out? You know, like, what happens at that point? Like, oh, we ran out. But there's all these laws of drawing, and then all of a sudden there's no more to draw for. And then what, is that it?
Well, it's true. I mean, we can extrapolate forward and say, given our understanding of dark energy, the universe will expand faster and faster apart. But that's just extrapolating for what's been happening over the last few billion years.
Sure.
It's possible that some new physics will come up and it'll contract again or expand even faster. You'll call it the Big Rip.
Yeah.
Or it could collapse again, and you get
it
could collapse again. You get what they call the Big Crunch.
Yeah.
But that would be new.
But there's got to be another big something.
There doesn't have to be. That would be new things that we haven't observed or have any evidence for. What we have evidence for right now is that the universe is accelerating apart faster and faster. We can't prove that this isn't some new phenomenon that happens tens of billions of years in the future. It's possible.
And I think if you stretch the density equation to the point where it's so thin, it's all pop. So there's got to be some creation.
Maybe.
Yeah. Otherwise,
you know, we try to stick with things that we can actually observe. You know, but,
so is it either or? Yeah. If there is dark matter, it will take care of all the potential changes to gravity that would be required.
Yes.
Or could there be?
There could be more, but we don't need them.
You wouldn't need them.
Right. If we detect wimps in the right amount.
Okay.
Then that would be the dark matter. Now, it's also possible that dark matter is not just one thing. Entirely possible that there are multiple kinds of dark matter, and we're only detecting one of them, or even looking for one of them. There's another theory for dark matter called the axion. The axion is a very light particle, also produced in the Big Bang, which could exist today. It has different physics motivations, having to do with fundamental symmetries of nature. Axions may exist. It's also possible that dark matter is a mix of axions and wimps. That's possible. Or it could be something we haven't thought of. That's also possible. So, in any case, it'll be an exciting time. Yes?
I was going to something that he said earlier that dark matter by itself produces matter.
Yes.
Because maybe it was the origin, or how did matter being created, or...
It was certainly the origin of a lot of the ordinary matter and photons from the Big Bang.
Yes.
But it doesn't explain the total amount of energy that came in the beginning.
Yeah.
That doesn't explain. That's a different question. Also a very important cosmology question.
Yeah.
That's a different question.
Very hard. Yeah, that's hard.
Yes.
A lot of physicists won't ask a really dumb question. But with the experiments in the super colliders, is it possible to create a black hole? What would happen to you?
Oh, shit.
So, there's no evidence that you could produce a black hole. And if you could produce a very short-lived black hole, it would likely be going at such a high energy that it would just pass right through the Earth.
It would only suck in the experiment.
I think... On that note, I'd really like to thank Dan for this really informative and provocative talk. And he mentioned Michael Faraday. I don't know how many of you know that Michael Faraday started the Christmas lectures in Oxford, I think, where it started off in 1871 or something, where he invited one scientist talk about a topic, and this might be Branford's Christmas thing. Thanksgiving.
Well, it was a real pleasure. Thank you for having me.